Chris asked me to say something about the process, and I rattled off an email where I said I'll talk about process, product, palette. But I think it was just the alliteration that sunk me in a bit, because when I thought about it a bit, well, palette and process were sort of the same thing. So, but I've cut it down a lot, partly so that we can see James's really fascinating work, and I wanted to see that. But also, just I don't really want to talk about Avanti's work or specifically, but just two sort of process strategies that I've come across, had suggested to me, or evolved a little bit. So it's really all about two little working methods, perhaps, that might be of use or might not. So just before we do that, though, probably people ask, don't they? People always ask, they ask me, and I'm sure they ask you, where do your ideas come from? As if they imagine that some finger comes out of the sky and there's a divine moment of inspiration and the idea comes fully formed to you, and then you just have to put the right trousers on and there it is. So when I can be bothered to answer, it's quite disappointing, because having ideas is a difficult thing, is it? I mean, we've all got rucksacks, metaphorical rucksacks full of ideas and stories and starting points. Like Edward talking about his method yesterday about having drawings, 150, 200 drawings of ideas, and then him and Sue get together and using their experience and their instinct to perform in their home down, go, yeah, that one, let's look at that one and that one. Where the idea comes from, we've all got those. So the process, how you get into that next stage is the thing that I thought I might speak about a bit. So first one there would be this idea of just making it, I'm halfway through making a new piece, which is called Full Circle, and it's a bit of a theme, isn't there, watching the Desperate Men's film last night, and again, it's probably to do with being a certain age, and I thought it'd be interesting. I saw a busking show in the Hat Fair a couple of years ago, and I was watching it as we were setting our show, and it was a really kind of old-fashioned juggling interactive show, and it had a circle of people around it, and they were all having a really great time. You could hear that sound, which we used to call the woof, where a whole audience just goes, they'll just react to something that is brilliant. It's in the centre of this donut of people. And I just thought, why people don't make that so much anymore? You know, they're having such a great time. You know, why? And that set me off thinking about maybe making a circular show, making a show in a full circle, and then linking that to the shows that we did when I first started, which were circle shows. So there's this kind of circularity of that, making the show that I might have made if I'd known what I know now, 25 years ago, revisiting that territory, but also working in a slightly off-grid way. So the idea of palette is, or rather a bit more than that, a restricted palette is a sort of painterly thing, which is because I'm a, like Ed, an art school background, where you lay out your palette of colours of the painting you're going to do. So it comes from the impressionists, really. So these are the colours we're going to do. They had lots of rules about what you could and couldn't use, like can't use black. You have to mix your colours. I think it's because they were painting outside and they were just too bloody lazy to carry a lot of tubes. But restricting your palette is quite a useful thing, because it kind of can hone it down to something. So, and you can use that as a colour straight away. And you see that a lot in carnival. I was noticing on Liz's film last night how the different teams in the carnival often have a palette, and that helps them stand out against the next one. But it's a thing I sometimes think about when we're making a little street show. What are the colours I'm going to use? Because that will make it kind of cohesive. So you can use it in a very straightforward way, just thinking about your palette. And or this is what I'm doing at the moment. And I'm sort of halfway through the development of this piece. I've done the research and development with Pete, who's here, and Pascal, who isn't here. And I did it in a different way, in a way that I've done before. And I took this idea of palette and extended it a bit further. So when we went down to the 101, the Creation Centre in Newbury, and we were there for 5 days, and I took with me a list, basically, of I'll read you the list out. This is what we started with on the first day. So the first bit are materials. So galvanized buckets, stirrup pumps, boiler suits, soft toys, a smoke effect, water, balloons, water or otherwise, and the idea of a bucket brigade. And then a list of sort of, if you like, concepts. Everything must be carried into the space. The space is empty at the beginning. There is no infrastructure, no air system, no flooring, nothing. It's an empty space. The performers have to bring it all in. It's completely off grid. There'll be no power requirement. We're not going to ask for power or water or all the things we ask for in our other shows. It will create the space itself. It will build the audience. So it will create that sense of buying in that James was just talking about. That's a fundamental part. And it will develop this really important thing with street kids shows, communitas. That is, we are a little community. We are making a contract with the performers. We're giving the performer, all right, we're here, a little bit of trust, we're going to give you 5 minutes, see how it goes, whatever. So that would be part of the concept of the piece. And then I put a couple of sort of impossible things in, like at the conclusion of the piece, the performers will disappear. And we do a certain amount of research about how that might happen with Dave Sackle, a friend of mine, where we looked at something called smoked sausage. That's a conversation for another time. And also water vapour with an interesting company in Sheffield who use water vapour to put fires out. And it's a pressurised cylinder and it just starves the atmosphere of oxygen, so it creates this fantastic water vapour. I thought that might be a way of disappearing at the end, there could be this effect, or a smoke effect. Pete and I talked about it, there'll be a cloud of smoke and then we would drop. But it was just sort of to have an impossible thing to end, just a completely impossible thing. Put that in, and that would be great. There'll be nothing there at the beginning, the show will happen, it's gone. And crucially, there wouldn't be an applause moment, there wouldn't be the moment where we go, ta-da, aren't we clever? We would have just gone, leaving the audience going, what happened then? And then I had a few little bits and pieces. So we're halfway through. We start with the palette, we're halfway through, done the research and development. I should say Pascal brought a brilliant system for the 5 days, which was a version of something called brain mapping. Some of you may know about brain mapping. So it's a slightly bastardised version of it. But what it enabled us to do is have a flip chart, mess about a bit, play around with things, and then write some key concepts down on the flip chart. Mess about some more right there. We didn't do anything about what anything meant until the last day, on the last morning, when we laid them out on the floor. It was about this much, if you remember, of flip chart on the floor. And then we started to draw them together. How many times have we said that? How many times did we come back to that concept? How many times did we do that? And then I forced a team, Pete and Pascal, forced them to put them into some sort of viable order. These key concepts that we seem to have found. We forced them into a, all right, now if we were to have to go out now this afternoon and make a show, how would we do it? How would we actually do that? That left us with like two lists, which I then took away to make a decision about which one we would then move forward with. And I did that, and then we met again in the theatre in the round in Stoke, and we did the next bit of development thing. We've done a bit more since then, but that's in a bit of a rush. That's the palette method. You're quite prescriptive about these ideas that you're going to look at, then mess around with them, then draw them together, push them into an order. So that's palette. And loosely, this method, and I think also Ed's method yesterday, reminded me of something that we made a show 2008 with Hilary Westlake. Hilary's a writer and a director who formed a very influential experimental theatre company in the, I suppose, the 80s, 70s into the 80s. And extraordinary experimental work, some of it fantastically successful, all of it intellectually very vigorous and rigorous. Their most successful, I suppose, show was called Circus Lumiere. It was a show with no animals. Extremely strange, funny show. Two in a tent, which was designed by one of Frank Lloyd Wright's students. So it had all kinds of interesting stuff going on. So working with Hillary, and at that time, she'd just come back from working for Disney. She made a kind of shock move, experimental theatre director goes to work for Disneyland Paris. And she was there for a couple of years as a sort of a creative director, trying to reimagine how their Mickey Mouse head people would interact with the public. And then she came back, and then we worked with her just after that. And she brought with her this thing called the Disney Creative Strategy. Some people know this? That's right, does everyone know this? So, and surprisingly, it turns out to be quite useful. And it works really quite well in a group, but it also works really well for me personally. I can sort of keep it in my head. So, just broadly, it's a thinking strategy, which is very simple. It has three stages. And the first stage is the dreamer. So the thinking mode that you put yourself in is the mode of the dreamer and the poet. And in that mode, that's all you can be. So this is analogous to your drawing, just doing drawings, perhaps. And if you're working in a group, you're not allowed to say, as I might, this would be the sort of thing I'd say, oh, I saw something a bit like that in a festival in 1992. Absolutely kills the process dead, you know, that sort of thing. So you have this dream, and in the dreams part of the process, anything is possible. You know, you can have anything you want, you can have cranes, you can make people disappear, you can do whatever you want. Everyone has to assume it's possible until you've completed that stage. Then you move into the next stage, which is called realist. And in the realist stage, you've got to still believe the ideas are possible, but you action plan it. You say, all right, we want somebody to fly over the top of the swimming pool. How do we do that? All right, we're going to need a crane. All right, how big does the crane need to be? 62 meters. Can we get a 62 meter crane? Is that? Yes, right, good. Well, it arrived. And so you make a little roadmap then for how you achieve the dreams. And then you move into the final stage, which is the critic, who I have subdivided into also the accountant. and the critic says, well, first of all, the critic says, is this a shit idea? You know, is this any good? Do we want to do this? And you positively, in a positive way, you criticise the idea and pull the idea apart and examine the implications of what happens if you did do it. So, you know, for example, if you're a small company and your plan, it's all action plan, and it's a massive show, the critic might say, all right, even if we could raise the money for this, even if we can do it and we can pull in partners, we're going to have a show at the end of it. What are we going to do with it? You know, where is all that? You saw John's five arches around the back, full of all this material. So that final stage, the critic critiques it from maybe an artistic perspective, but also critiques it from, is this a safe thing? Is this a safe thing for us to do as a company? And then that's the process. So it differs from other similar ones, like the Edward de Bono one, which is all about wearing coloured hats, and you can only wear one hat at a time and say therefore one thing. The Disney one is just this linear three-stage process, and it really helps me when I'm back in the Avanti display doodling department, in my one of the many departments in the Avanti organisation. You know, when I'm in there, it can remind me about not to shoot myself, not to sabotage the idea before it's got. You know, either I've even thought about it or mentioned it to him. So those are my two. I'm offering two sort of strategies that have been of use to me. But we may work. We use different ways of making them, but those are the most common ones. And then I thought I would just show you a little bit. There's no video of this new show yet, apart from I got these photographs from somebody who took some photographs of the work in progress in Bath, and he must have used one of those fast shutter things, you know. So I've made them into a little animation. Make it work. Very, very short. So this is the conclusion of the full circle show, which turns out to have a 120 buckets in it. This happens. This is exactly what happens in the show. Sorry, including my job. The show buffers.
Really on, yeah.
You chant buffering.
Interesting. There is a bit of chanting. When you look at the photographs of this, all the audience, it's fantastic. They're all going like this.
Yeah.
But actually what they're doing is they are singing. At this moment they're singing. And they start by going, inside the town, and then the audience walk them up. We encourage the audience to wall them up, and it's about 4 meters high. And they don't know what happens at the end. So there's, and then we incite them into this act that they have no real way of knowing how safe that is. And it's about their trust in us. You know, that's what we're testing now. We've done a lot of things before where they've stoned us. Get them just to throw things at us, and we stand there and take it. It's a tragic moment. We play a game with them about throwing and catching, and then we invite them to throw things at us. But we're little balloons in the ice, so they don't really hurt. But they sometimes they come back. Kids come back and get another one. So there's a moment of being human, and then we come from that. And then we give them this other task, which we show them how to build this wall. But having taken one of them and put them inside. So it's about that, we're testing that kind of communitas thing, kind of to the limit, really.
Sorry,
I think tech is now, I've never had tech before, which is amazing.
I'm confident.
You made it worse.
Just buffering.
Buffering.
Yeah, we're buffering over here.
And there's no water. There's buckets, but no water.
No, we did try a version where instead of rice filled things, they were water filled, but water bottles. Interesting that from my original palette of ideas, we did manage to get nearly everything in, but there isn't any water in it, there aren't the stirrup pumps in it, and the water balloons, I was going to say, I'm quite good at finding taps in my history of doing water shows. We'd look at a tap to fill the water balloons. It turned out to be a hot water tap. We checked it out the day before, went down to the basement, filled the water. So we now had water balloons that were boiling hot. Well, that's a slightly different thought, isn't it? Going to be bombarded with boiling hot water. So we got some ice from the local restaurants in the central bath, and we turned an ice bath, and we tried to cool the water. But then we decided maybe water balloons weren't really the idea. Well, there is sound going all the time, which made these little devices with Dave Southall, our friend James and my friend Dave Southall. Because I thought the idea of time was quite important, that full circle, and something a little bit tension filled, like a ticking, like a bomb or a clock, something ticking, but also maybe the sound of drip going in a bucket. So made these fantastic little battery driven devices that kind of peck the bucket. And there are six of them, and they all kind of make this 6-point dripping thing. So all the time this performance is happening, there's this dripping going from somewhere. And then at the moment of decision, they're on a remote control. So you can just press a fob and they all stop. And although it's very quiet, when they stop, it's quite apparent rather than when they start. And then just look at a few things now, like how do you spread the decision? Should there be 10 people involved? Should there be 4? Who do you give it to? Try and give it to children. Should the child that makes the decision? So far there's only been one refusal, one person just couldn't do it. So there you are, that's two strategies and our goals.
Fantastic, thank you. That's really, really insightful. But now we've got two more things before we eat, which one was the idea that we can have some very short, which will be really short,
half an hour,
practical
maybe,
things to do so we can move around a little bit, which includes acro balance in this space and Maureen in the meeting room space and the word thing collective. We could do in the either in the kitchen space or the corridor space. We were running out of spaces.
Or upstairs.
Or upstairs. So it's a paper-based thing, so we could do that upstairs. So we've only really got half an hour.
Choose.
It's
make a decision to
electronic.